Good afternoon. This is a very difficult time. Anand said that this is probably the last working day for most of us before Diwali, and that too after lunch. So puts a double pressure on all of us. I'm really happy and honored to be here and chairing the session with galaxy of leaders from solar field. And next one and a half hours, I'm sure you will have very valuable insight into where EPC and O&M is heading. Rather than losing time, let me just quickly get on to my presentation. When I decided to have a short presentation here, I thought something different needs to be done. Rather than just telling, when I talk about trackers, what trackers do, how they add efficiency, how they add to the revenue, etc., etc., based on our experience, the challenges that EPC and customers many times face when installing trackers and how these can be mitigated. And this is from our own learnings. So I thought I will cover that part. Tracking the tracker. You know, trackers have been there for a long time. Last year, it has seen a quantum jump in terms of, it is estimated that half of the utility scale installations in US were with tracker. Coming to India, we are all price sensitive market. The earlier panelist said, kitna deti hai, correct? So, and same is the trend in Indian solar as well. Now, on top of the main solar plant, if someone says that you need to invest more on tracker, then most of the customers are not quite happy with that. But, and GST is added since 1st of July, so again, 5% cost of the plant have gone up. In spite of that, does it really make sense to go for trackers? With the prices of solar modules going up by more than 2 rupees in last 3 months, it is making all the more sense to put trackers and get that extra benefit. If we look at penetration in Indian market, I think we are still lagging to the developing world. I read somewhere that last year about a gigawatt cumulative capacity, not more than 30% has been with trackers. But I see a very strong pipeline for the current year. And in this session, as well as I know the next session, there are stalwarts from tracker industry and they will echo this. Do you remember in the first session, people spoke about two aspects when it comes to solar. The cost of land as well as the reliability of solar. Solar power starts generating pretty late and it has a curve, etc. First and foremost, today solar is termed as infirm power. Any infirm power is a lame player. Nobody wants, you know, solar having dependency and crushes like subsidy, etc. The tracker, as we all know, it really flattens the curve, and that helps because at the time that our load peaks in the morning, it starts picking up. That's the time tracker solar also comes up. Without tracker, there is a long curve before which by 10:30, 11, 11:30, solar really starts peaking, whereas tracker helps that. With 100 gigawatt and 175 gigawatt of renewable power, we are looking at predictability in grid. So if we know for sure what's the generation from renewable energy, the grid stability can be achieved. These are the parameters in my opinion. The others benefits are implicit, they have to be there. With incremental cost of power, we must get additional benefit in terms of savings. But these are the ones in my opinion which are the game changer for trackers. Just to have a look at it, this is how the typical tracker, I mean curve of generation with tracker and without tracker looks at. Now this is a better stable generation compared to those without tracker. And for this, I am going to talk about row tracker. And pardon me, sometimes I'll keep referring about our tracker, but it's not about marketing my company, but the inherent features that are built in this row tracker based on the challenges we face. There are two parameters, and I was vindicated when the first panelist kept on talking about land usage as well as operations and maintenance of the systems. Land is at premium in India. We know that. And with tracker, we need additional land. But with that additional land, can we generate more? So effectively, per acre generation of kilowatt hours goes down. That's what the tracker does. This particular row tracker that I'm talking about has a unique design feature, which conventional single axis tracker are having row trackers, are having single panel row in portrait, We have gone for two panels in portrait model. So practically, we are doubling the capacity of installation in the same length. And this is so elegant that that is the best utilization of land that we can look at. The second parameter is complexity of the land and its contour. The table type of trackers have a problem that if we are talking about 100 megawatt of plant, 50 megawatt of plant, I mean, even if we take 100 megawatt, we are talking about 400 acres of land. We will be really lucky if we have a flat table land for all 400 acres. Often than not, we will have a lot of undulations on the land, and it becomes a hell of a problem. Either you level it, and then it's additional cost to that, it takes more time to do that, and who bears that cost? Whereas an individual row tracker overcomes this problem. In fact, individual row tracker can be installed with a north-south slope of even up to 15 degrees. Look at the odd shape of this particular installation. If individual tracker is on the row, then you are okay to have different number of panels in each row, different length of row, each of the row, because each row is independently tracked. Whereas the moment you have a box type or a table type, then you are necessarily constrained with going for the similar configuration of all the rows in that table. That's one feature that a row tracker brings in. Let us come to O&M. As an EPC, when we are selling solar power plants to customers, we tell that this is very low on maintenance, correct? And the reason solar systems are low on maintenance, because the main components that go into typical solar system is solar modules or panels and inverters, and none of them have any moving parts. The moment we talk about trackers, these are all moving parts. There are drives, there will be actuators, and that will add to operations as well as maintenance of the system. And that's where another concern area. The way we handled this was, first, we went, instead of actuator, we went for BLDC motor. We are generating DC power, why not use the same brushless DC motor? And that gives an incremental benefit. This also means less number of drives. Less number of drives, we all know, will also lead to lower cost as well as lower maintenance. We have a proven compact gearbox. We are on the lunchtime, people were talking about guarantees of structure. People are talking about plastic structures. Will they really last 25 years? We need to have this gearbox last 25 years. What's the guarantee that this gearbox will last 25 years? The gearbox that we have developed is derived from automobile industry. Many of us, I mean, do you remember those Fiats and Ambassadors? They have been in service for more than 30 years. All problems, I mean, at one point of time, they said that everything makes noise other than horn. But we have never heard about gearbox having a problem. So those are the gearbox that we have inherited into this design, and that is making it more robust. This doesn't involve any on-site fabrication. For huge tonnage of this material to undertake on-site fabrication is itself a big challenge. And this type of design doesn't need any on-site fabrication. In case of any problem, bearings are the one where there can be some replacement required with over 5 to 7 years of time. The downtime in such case is not even 15 minutes. That's the limited maintenance that is required on the system. I just want to share the photographs. You can see a very compact gearbox on the left, and when it is mounted on the system, it gives you a very, very elegant design. Coming to the maintenance part. Now, the maintenance that is required on the system is one, cleaning of the panels. The major component goes into that, other than the system maintenance. Now, when we are having rows of trackers or rows of panels and we are going for panel cleaning, then it is necessary that we can do it in a minimal trips, and this cannot be manual. Now, because of the row tracker, we can have obstruction-free access or passage between the rows. And the picture that you will see, there are two features to that. Because of the row tracker, there is nothing in between the rows, and the cleaning machine can pass through in between the rows. and there is what is called a cleaning mode at which the panels are, you know, aligned. So with these two, the number of trips for the cleaning machine goes down to half. This all takes us to improvement in the performance of tracker. On an average, this type of single axis tracker, we have seen adds to increased radiation on the panels by about 20%, 18 to 21%, that is the proven data. It improves project IRR. Over last 2 to 3 years, majority of EPCs and developers are facing a heat from customer that their IRRs under pressure are under pressure because of that magic number of 2.44. How do you improve your IRR by having additional revenue? This tracker gives you that additional revenue. And of course, that means higher payback. So I thought I will cover very specific points in terms of the tracker, the challenges, and how do we overcome that. With this, I come to the end of my presentation.